Happy Monday, everybody. I don't know what you ate for breakfast this morning. Hey, thanks you so much for joining us here for KARE 11 News at Noon. We're coming back from a weekend of breaking news following shots fired at former President Donald Trump. We're covering the newest details, plus how a campaign is continuing.
In fact, the former president is in Milwaukee today for the Republican National Convention. I'm following how the campaign's moving forward.
Mm-hmm. And if you take a look outside, my goodness, a lot of people wondering what in the world is going on with the weather.
Yeah, some showers still lingering across parts of the metro, but most of the thunderstorm activity is well off to our east. In fact, most of that has faded after moving into southwestern Wisconsin just a couple hours ago. It was a rather busy morning. We had several severe storms that did produce some large hail, golf ball size hail across parts of the Minnesota River Valley. We had wind gusts over 60 miles per hour, including one flipped over semi truck due to windy conditions out in Chippewa County. Again, that was earlier this morning. A lot quieter as we head into the second half of the day. Temperatures still rather cool. We're at 74 degrees right now, but notice where we've seen sunshine further north and west. Brainerd right now is at 80 degrees, and as long as we see a couple hours of sunshine this afternoon, low to mid 80s is going to be a good bet for us. In the meantime, however, still cloudy, still dealing with some wet roadways out there right now, and your hour by hour forecast gives us some partial clearing, maybe a spotty shower or storm late this afternoon, but again, most of us will probably get through the rest of the afternoon totally dry. Not only the rest of the day today, but most of this week, we're looking at quiet weather. More sunshine, especially over tomorrow and into Wednesday. It will be turning a bit cooler and certainly a big drop in humidity. More on your changing 7-day forecast coming up, Alexis.
Ben, thank you. A major development into our news from just over 2 hours ago. A Florida judge dismissed former President Donald Trump's classified documents case. The judge says Jack Smith's appointment as special counsel was illegal. He was the one who originally charged Trump with mishandling top secret documents after he left the White House. And Smith can now appeal the judge's decision. The decision comes on the first day of the Republican National Convention in Milwaukee. We're taking a live look as it begins, just 2 days after the former president was caught in gunfire this weekend. Now, CeCe, a lot of folks wondering, what can we expect today?
Oh, for sure. I can break it all down right now. Now, this four-day convention, it starts later this afternoon in Milwaukee, and the convention is here to formally nominate Donald Trump as the GOP presidential candidate. Trump also expected to announce his choice for a running mate, but we can't forget that this convention kicks off just 48 hours after the former president survived an assassination attempt. Trump saying his convention speech is now changing because of it. In an interview with the Washington Examiner, the former president saying, quote, "It's going to be a whole different speech now, a lot different than it would have been 2 days ago," adding, quote, "This is a chance to bring the whole country, even the whole world together." You'll remember images of Trump with his face bloodied, fists in the air, just moments after the shots were fired. These images right here, those images now being embraced by his campaign and fundraising appeals and by supporters touting his, quote, toughness. Just hours ago, Republicans reacted to the shooting at a breakfast ahead of the RNC.
This is an extraordinary election. It was an extraordinary election before Saturday night. I became even more so Saturday night. I was went on TV. I was very emotional about it, and I had a hard time actually going on TV that night because I've known Trump for 30 years, and you watch somebody you know getting shot in real time. It's pretty horrifying.
Now, while Trump's speech may be changing, convention security won't be. Despite the assassination attempt, authorities say they've made no changes to the security plan since they already have a robust one. In 30 minutes, I'll have more on what that plan is.
CeCe, thank you. Here's what we know so far about the other victims of Saturday's shooting in Pennsylvania. State police identified the man who died as 50-year-old KARE Comportor. According to Pennsylvania's governor, he was killed in an attempt to protect his wife and two daughters. Two other men, a 57-year-old and a 74-year-old, were also shot. The hospital says they are both expected to be okay. Well, today the FBI is trying to figure out the motive of the gunman. We know he was 20 years old and he appears to have acted alone. The FBI says he used a semi-automatic rifle registered to his father. He opened fire from a rooftop just over 150 yards from where the former president was speaking. Another investigation is also underway to determine how the shooter was even able to get into that position where he was able to shoot at the former president. Michelle Beck breaks down what we know about the rally's security.
In the wake of an assassination plot, criticism is spiraling about the security in place. Some witnesses say law enforcement were standing in places where they couldn't have seen the suspected shooter on the roof. That points to questions like how the suspected shooter got on the roof less than 150 yards from the rally stage. New video shows he was able to fire at least 8 shots from his position before he was taken out by snipers. The FBI, Homeland Security, and independent investigators are all looking into what happened. According to NBC News, a special agent heading the FBI's Pittsburgh office said it's the Secret Service who would have been in charge of securing the scene, including outside of the security perimeter where the shooter was.
The buck does stop with the U.S. Secret Service. It's their plan. You're responsible, so you can't deflect blame on anybody else.
If that bullet was 2 inches to the right, it would have penetrated the former president's forehead, and we would have a great American tragedy on our hands.
FBI officials say the suspected shooter acted alone in the attack. They are still searching for a motive for the shooting. In the newsroom, Michelle Beck, KARE 11 News.
Michelle, thank you. And across the country, lawmakers are calling for a thorough search into exactly what went wrong, allowing something like this to happen. That includes Minnesota Senator Amy Klobuchar.
This is an assault on our democracy. And political violence has no place in our democracy, no home in our democracy. And out of this, I think a few things. One, as citizens, it's our job to bring down the rhetoric, to understand that what unites our country is so much bigger than what divides us.
Minnesota Republicans who are also in Milwaukee right now say are also weighing in. Kip Christensen from Monticello is one of the 74 delegates, and he says it sparked resolve and unity among the Republican Party.
This man just doesn't stop. He doesn't quit. We are incredibly, incredibly grateful and fired up, and this is the safest place to be in the country right now, surrounded by a ton of law enforcement, of state, federal, local.
We will continue to cover this story as we learn more, and we'll have the latest developments out of the RNC throughout the next 4 days. And you can find our coverage on air and at KARE11.com. Well, back at home, police are investigating an overnight shooting in northeast Minneapolis. This was the scene just before 11:30, just off of Lowry Avenue. Police say they recovered a handgun and multiple shell casings. No word yet on any victims or a motive. We have reached out to police for more information. We're waiting to hear more from the Vikings after wide receiver Jordan Addison was arrested on suspicion of a DUI late Friday night. The California Highway Patrol says one of the officers found Addison asleep behind the wheel of a car near LAX. The Vikings say they are aware of Jordan Addison's arrest and are currently gathering more information regarding that incident. There is still a lot of cleanup happening this afternoon following the weekend storms. This is in St. Louis Park. Trees blocking the roads, debris covering the sidewalks. Few people who live in the area tell us this is the worst damage they've seen in years. At this hour, some customers still in the dark, according to Xcel's outage map. They expect to have the lights back on by tonight. Well, across the country, more than 100 million people are under heat alerts. On the East Coast, feels like temperatures are expected to surpass 100 degrees. Heat alerts are also in effect in much of the central U.S. Houston, Texas is also expected to reach a triple-digit heat index though many people have been without air conditioning for nearly a week now. About 300,000 people still do not have power following those powerful storms from Beryl.
Well, after massive flooding and heavy rain in the Twin Cities, we want to highlight some of the people who are coming together to clean things up. Over the weekend, about 60 volunteers helped pick up the shores of Bassett Creek.
We've had so much rain that there's a lot of ground cover and other vegetation that's creeping up on those trees, and we want to keep them protected. So we're having volunteers clear a 5-foot area around the trees so we can get at them, mulch them, water them if we need them.
Saturday, volunteers picked up garbage and planted trees on 6 acres of land along the shores of the creek. It's all part of an oral history project with the Hennepin History Museum.
People really like getting in there and getting their hands dirty and seeing a difference before versus after. And when we show you the pictures of what it looked like before the volunteers to it, the difference is so great you wouldn't even believe it's the same park.
The cleanup was the second straight weekend of service events for the group. Meanwhile, about 80,000 acres of Minnesota land could soon belong to the federal government. The DNR is considering the sale of school trust land in the Boundary Waters. In the past, profits from mining and logging on the land supported schools, but now that the state's constitution forbids that, officials say they have to sell it to continue funding Minnesota's public school system. The DNR is consulting the U.S. Forest Service about potentially acquiring 15,000 acres from the Superior National Forest.